I would like to thank the organizer of this symposium for inviting me to give this speech. I also would like to mention that every time I come to Rio, I have something like a revival of my PhD student time. I found here a lot of friends, most of them here in the university. Okay. The title of my talk is Multiscale Modeling for Material Failure. And the author of this work are Sebastián Toro and my colleague Pablo Sánchez from Argentina, from this institution here in Santa Fe, Professor Pablo Blanco and Raúl Feijó from this institution from Brazil, and Eduardo Neto from the United Kingdom. Okay. I would like to start with the motivation of multiscale fracture, presenting the most typical test in engineering, the uniaxial tensile bar test. Let us consider, for example, a metal bar, typically steel, which is subject to uniaxial tensile loading. We see in the material some small inclusion of the order of micrometers, which are rigid and hard. When the sample is loaded, this inclusion suffers a process of decohesion from the matrix. Then, if this point are embedded into a region of high plastic deformation, this point suffers an exponential growth, and then the process of coalescence of the points, and finally the process of strain localization, and leading to the final fracture of the specimen. Of course, that the structural level are in the order of centimeters, and this phenomenon are of the order of micrometers. Here I present a very nice picture showing the evolution of a fracture process. Typically here you can see the coup and cone fracture mechanism, which is observed in this kind of test. In this picture I show the coalescent phenomenon at this scale, at the micrometer scale, is the phenomenon have taken place between two neighbor inclusion. Of course that we can center our attention in how to model every scale, how to model the phenomena in every scale, but it is not the interest of this talk. Here, instead, we are interested in to understand and know how the information flow from one scale to the other. That is the problem of this, that I will try to explain this talk. In heterogeneous material modeling, it is common to use the concept of the representative volume element. I have taken here the definition coined by Hill, and where, of course, he said that the RVE is a sample of material which represents the whole of the behavior of the material. But in particular, I would like to draw the attention about the size which should have the RV, in the sense that in this concept is implicit the idea that if we take a sample which is larger than the RV size, then the homogenized response of the material is exactly the same. That is a key point that I will return back in the next slide. I have categorized in three different models the dust that actually are at the present are used, models which are using the RVE concept. In the first one, in the hierarchical model, the information flow from the small scale to the up scale in the following way. A different instance of the RVE are solved, and after that, an adjusted model is built. Then, when I need, this is done completely independent of the behavior of the macro scale. Then, when I need to solve the macro scale, I need to solve the constitutive relation that I pick up the information only from the adjusted model. This is typically the information is going from this scale to this here. A paradigmatic case of this model is the Gerson model. In the semi-concurrent model, the information flows in both directions. Every time I need to evaluate the constitutive relation, I insert the strains in the RVE, resolve a problem in the microscale, and then go with the stresses up, go to the upscale through a certain homogenization process. And finally, the concurrent model, which is typical when separation scale is not very large, the microscale or the mesoscale is introduced into the microscale, and with given interfaces, we can impose kinematic compatibility and balance of forces. Our interest in this talk is about this kind of model, which I go to explain in the next slide. Okay, I will motivate a brief description of semi-concurrent model using a classical formulation. I call classical formulation the formulation that was typically used in several years ago, and particularly I would like to present the formulation given by Professor Sobsanetan Feijóo, which are co-author of this work. In this approach, the multiscale model consists of every time I need to evaluate the constitutive relation, I insert the macro strain into the macro scale. And after that, for a given process of homogenization, I scale up the stresses. The conceptual formulation is as follows. I need to define how the micro strain are defined in the micro scale. In this case, in the classical approach, it is defined through the addition of two terms. The first term is the insertion of the macro strain, and in this case, the insertion is homogeneously distributed over all the RVE. The second term is a fluctuation term. I call U mu tilde the fluctuation of displacement in the RVE. Then we are asking to the model that the average strain, the fluctuation strain in the microcell should be zero. This restriction is equivalent to this restriction put on the boundaries of the cell, which finally define the space where the solution, the fluctuation solution, should live. A second very important assumption in the model is to consider the Hill-Mandel variational principle. Here, this principle is something like an energetic consistency between the terms in the macro scale and terms in the micro scale. In the macro scale, the internal virtual power, this term is the stresses, of course, and this here represent a variational admissible strains in the macro scale, should be equal to the average value of the equivalent of the equivalent internal virtual power, but in the micro scale. If we introduce here the kinematic defined in the previous slide, then two consequences can be derived from this principle. The first one consists of producing variation in the macro strains, and from this equation we can derive the homogenization operator. This means that this is typically the equation that I am using to transfer information from the lower scale to the upper scale in stresses. And the second equation, by performing variation on fluctuation displacement, I can obtain the self-equilibrium of the microstresses. Okay. In short, briefly, the summary of the variational formulation consists of taking a number of hypotheses of the model and then deriving consequences. Of course, the consequences is the rule that I will use to transfer information between two scales. This typically is the framework that I will use to extend model for evaluating fracture in different scales. But the problem is that I cannot use directly the same procedure in fracture problem due to three typical issues which are related to the scale bridging equation. The first issue consists of the following idea. How we should redefine the boundary condition in order to capture fracture. This means I have drawn here a typical example. Consider, for example, a body having a periodic microstructure. Then I can took an RVE with periodic boundary condition, and the classical analysis worked rather well. But if we observe that the fracture is propagating across the body, then the periodicity condition is lost. The first issue then consists on how I should redefine the boundary condition in order that this phenomenon can be captured in the microscale. The second issue is related with the phenomenon of size effect in a structural problem. It is a very well-known phenomenon which consists of the following. If we take an structure which characteristic dimension is D, and we load this structure until the complete degradation, we can plot in this variable in something like stresses versus average strain, we can plot the response of this structure, which look like something similar to this curve. But if we double or scale the structure to, for example, for a factor 2, we can observe that in the same variables, the behavior is similar until to obtain some instability point, and after that, the behavior changes completely. The phenomenon is, of course, due to a transference of volumetric energy, which is proportional to D, elastic volumetric energy, to fracture energy, which is typically 2D. Of course, that this phenomenon is completely recovered or transferred if I consider instead that this is a structural problem, I consider that it is an RVE, then in the homogenized variables, I will have exactly the same response. Then the second question is how to avoid this kind of size dependence when I will represent an RVE in fracture. And finally, the third issue consists in the following problem. I can model a fracture, for example, in the macroscale, which is striped, but which came from two different geometrical shapes in the macroscale. For example, in the microscale, I can have a straight fracture or a zigzag fracture. Of course, that in homogenized values in the fracture energy, I need to obtain a more ductile response when the fracture is going in something like a zigzag. This has to do typically with surface fractality that are at the present are some line of research trying to evaluate which is the relation between fracture energy versus fractality of the surface in fracture. Okay, what I want is that my model try to capture this phenomenology, okay? Well, the new model that we have proposed, we have called it with this name, and have been presented in a series of papers in the last year, I want to show you the brief description of the model. The first one is that we will consider that there are a separation of scale between the macro and micro. We will use two kinds of different models for evaluating the fracture process. In the first part of the loading process, I will use a classical multiscale model, which was explained in the previous slide, but after crossing a bifurcation time, I will change to a cohesive multiscale model. This cohesive model is explained here. We introduce into the macroscale a cohesive model, which is taken from this reference, which is mechanically defined through this parameter, the tractions in the face of the surface, the displacement shunt, the normal to the cohesive surface, and some parameter, some length parameter like the width of the band. Then the model proposed to inject the shunt, displacement shunt, into the microscale and through some homogenization process to obtain the tractions and scale up this term. Again, the formalism of the model goes as follows. First, we define the kinematics in the microscale in a similar way as was done with the classical model, but now I would like to mention that the formulation is in increments, then the letter D here, in all terms, mean increment of the magnitude. The microstrain are the addition of these two terms, which are similar to the classical model, but now we insert also the jumps into the microscale. The insertion of the jump is defined through this function here, where it is multiplied, this term is multiplied by a collocation function, which only gives different values from zero in the localized region of the microstrain. Then the displacement jump theta is only introduced in this region of the model. Also, we have introduced in our last contribution, we have introduced a tortuosity index in the way that we distribute the displacement jump that will be proved I will prove the use of this parameter in one of the slides when I make the validation of the model. Okay. Then the kinematical admissibility, we ask for that the fluctuation, the strain fluctuation in the microscale should be zero in the same way as it was done in the classical model. It imposes boundary condition on the microcell, but also as we introduce a new kinematical variable here, it is related with a new kinematical boundary condition that lives only in the boundary of the strain localized zone in the microscale. This, of course, these two conditions define the space where the solution, the fluctuation solution, should live. We introduce again the Hill-Mandel variational principle, now in terms of traction versus shunt displacement. This is the virtual internal power in the macro scale should be equal to the equivalent virtual internal power in the micro scale. And then, introducing the kinematics, we can derive the two consequences again. By making variation in the macro strain, we obtain the operator which defines the homogenization of the traction vector, the scaling up of the traction vector, and also the micromechanical equilibrium. A summary of the formulation consists again in the formulating some kind of hypothesis, typically the kinematical hypothesis, and introducing the Hill-Mandel variational principle to derive the homogenization operator for the transference of information between scales. We have validated the model through three studied cases. In the first case, we have analyzed the objectivity of the model with respect to changing the size of the RV. In this case, I have used a periodic microstructure which was loaded with a given strain in the time, and then we have solved two different cells. One cell is I call the 1x1 cells, this here, and another cell called the 1x2, which is the double of the initial cells. Here, I have plotted the tractions, the homogenized traction vector at the macro scale that provide our model. This is the component, the normal component of the traction, and in blue is the shear component of the traction, And we can see that the solution obtained with the two microcells are practically indistinguishable. In the second case that we present here, it consists to evaluate how sensitive is the fracture energy to tortuosity in the microscale. So we have defined an almost academic test where in the microscale we have a uniaxial tensile, and in the microscale it is defined by an elastic matrix having bands which could damage. In one case, in the first case, the band are straight, and the second case, the band is tortuous, forming a zigzag line. And the factor of tortuosity is defined, the theta factor that I have shown in previous slide, is defined as the average of the normal vector times the length of the, in the microscale of the localized zone, versus the length of the localized zone. Theta in the first case is 1, and in the second case is square 2 over 2. The solution of these two microstructures have been compared in this slide. And we also have compared our solution, the multiscale model, versus direct numerical simulation. Direct numerical simulation, we have modeled the complete macroscale by introducing the microscale structure. Here, in blue, for example, the blue solution is the multiscale for the zigzag bands, and is compared with versus the DNS in zigzag bands, which are the square symbol here, and they coincide exactly, even when the bands are horizontal or when the bands are in zigzag. It means that the DNS solution and MS, the multiscale solution, provide exactly the same response. But the most important here question, issue, is that when evaluating the microscale with horizontal bands versus zigzag band, even when in the macroscale I get the same fracture, I observe that arises a difference in the fracture energy, the effective fracture energy that we capture in the macroscale. That is just the phenomenon we have been searching for. Well, the last test is again a comparison between multiscale formulation versus direct numerical simulation. It's an L-panel, it's a material sensing like concrete. Typically, the experiment were concrete in this case. The structure is an L-shaped panel subject to this type of load, is fixed here, then bending like a bending process arises here, and a fracture evolves from this point to here in a not straight line. The mesh structure typically in concrete is same kind of aggregates which are hard, embedded in a matrix of cement-like material. Here are some details of the modeling in the mesoscale, and finally the models that we have adopted for performing the validation test. In the mesoscale, we have taken two different models with arbitrary or random distribution of aggregates and shapes. Exactly the same in direct numerical simulation, we have used different distribution of aggregates. And the solution, the structural solution in vertical force P versus displacement, vertical displacement U is plotted here. This is the experimental value, in this one are the experimental value, and this here are our solution where we have compared the multiscale model with one distribution of aggregate and the other distribution of aggregate in blue and red, and the direct numerical simulation again are these two. Of course, the solution are pretty well with respect to the experimental result. Some of the mesoscale fracture that pattern we have obtained in different points along the crack of the macro scale model. And well, the conclusion of this work are the following. We have presented the multi-scale variational formulation for material final simulation. In fact, I have presented a two-scale model, but this two-scale model can be extended to simulation of multi-scale phenomenon, rather trivially. Complex models of failure at macro as well as microscale are captured. The objectivity we have evaluated that our model is objective by changing the size of the RV. Also, we have shown that the fracture energy is sensitive to the tortuosity in the microscale. And finally, we have performed a rigorous proof of the multiscale model compared with direct numerical simulation. Of course, I have not addressed some important topic in this aspect, but this should be addressed in other opportunity. Thank you very much for your attention.